Begin if you want.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining. I think we can get started. I will turn it over to our wonderful moderator, Pam Dixon.
Hello. It is an absolute pleasure to be with all of you here today. We have an extremely distinguished panel, and this is a most distinguished and timely event. So welcome, and just a few items of housekeeping before we begin. So first, there are interpretations available to you. There is English, French, Spanish, and American Sign Language, or just sign language, excuse me. And so the trick is with the interpretation, once you select your chosen interpretation, please do stick with it. So that will avoid any technical difficulties. But in general, I think that's the only technical thing there. There is a chat moderator, so please, we welcome you to join in the chat. Please ask your questions. There will be a time where there will be plenty of back and forth between the panelists and you. So please ask your best and most challenging questions, and we'll all be really happy to join them into the discussion. So very quickly, let's see if there's any other housekeeping. Apologies. Yes, chat box, check. And then the languages, check. All right. Okay, so let's go ahead and begin. So as all of us have lived through and know, in 2020, when COVID-19 became a pandemic, it impacted all of our lives so profoundly, so deeply. And as we all know, there has been much suffering, and the suffering has been disproportionate in many, many very complex ways. As we work through how COVID-19 and how our digital acceleration as a result of COVID-19 has impacted gender equality, here's the question. Can all of the problems that have been laid even more bare than usual, can the problems that have become more striking, and can the equality, which seems even further away, can we make this into an opportunity now with COVID-19? My answer is yes. And the panelists are here to discuss with us how. So let me introduce the panelists very quickly for you. First, we have Linda Schomo. She is the founder and CEO of Easy Pay. Linda founded Easy Pay in 2010, and she is one of the very few women founders and CEOs in the Balkans fintech sector. Well done, Linda. Well done, you. Apart from running EasyPay, Linda is also a board member of the Albanian IT Association, the Albanian Consulting Network, Women in Business Committee, American Chamber of Commerce, and co-founder of the Network of Albanian Women Entrepreneurs. So that's very, very impressive. And then Hawa Yoki is also an esteemed panelist with us today. She is a youth advisory member with Plan International Sierra Leone. Hawa leads Plan International Sierra Leone's Youth Innovation Initiatives, and she's a member of the Beijing Plus 25 Youth Task Force, well done, which supports and guides UN Women's efforts to place young people at the center of the Beijing 25 process. She is passionate about women's involvement in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Well done. And then we also have Mr. Magnus Magnusson. He is the Director for Partnerships and Outreach for of the Social and Human Sciences sector of UNESCO. The departmental agenda includes the achievement of social inclusion and gender equality, advancing youth development, promotion of values through sports, anti-racism and anti-discriminatory agenda, and ethics of artificial intelligence. Very well done. Thank you all for your work. So Hawa, beginning with you, I'm very, very curious about the work that you've been doing and the context of your work. What are your thoughts about how COVID-19 has changed the landscape, and how can we arrive at more equality, more transparency, and more fairness despite the pandemic, or perhaps even because of it? What are your thoughts on this issue?
Thank you so much. So I think the COVID-19 has impacted each and every one of us here. For us here in Sierra Leone, we are still fighting the pandemic. This has impacted us because since I'm running the Plan International Youth Innovation Lab, this has really taken a toll on how we meet, how we engage with people. And because of this, we have been having a limited number of people that have been coming in and working in our innovation lab. And I think this is a big impact. Looking at the fact that in terms of technology, Sierra Leone is still not on the global map. We're still fighting to reach out to people, to engage people in terms of technology, what it is about, how can we use technology to solve issues. So with this whole pandemic and it's seizing our workflow, this has really been a setback. But notwithstanding, we have also have a lot of positive impact, because now we have mapped out where we want to be, how we want to operate, giving us a short period of time, how we can move from in-person learning to digital space, that is to using technologies like Zoom, how we can introduce these things in our schools, our communities. So this is the positive aspect of COVID, but yet still we're still trying to bridge the gap between how we can introduce technology to schools and communities, how we can be able to young people can be able to access it. Thank you.
May I ask you a follow-up question? Have you found, so you mentioned that there were some challenges. I'm very curious. One of the things in my work at the World Privacy Forum, we work a lot with ID for Africa, and they had the most amazing presentation on quite a few different jurisdictions within Africa on some of the challenges that the pandemic had brought, and also some of the things that are changing, as you just mentioned. What would you say your greatest obstacle was, and what would you say is your greatest pandemic success?
Oh, okay. So for me here, my greatest obstacle in looking at a general perspective was how to use the internet. Because this is something, the internet is something that is not really introduced hair in Sierra Leone. Like, not everybody have access to it in the first place. When you go to the interior part, when you go to schools, we don't have internet in our schools, in our most of our universities. So this has been a big challenge, because when we notice that most of the classes have been moved online, we see a high number of pupils that are not studying or that did not study. We see a high number of dropouts. We saw a high number of teenage pregnancy due to the fact that girls are not introduced to internet or do not know how to use internet or how to use a computer. So this is like one of the huge setback that COVID-19 brought. But then looking at the positive side, we were able to see this as a problem, and now we're finding solutions to it. So where there is no internet, they have started providing internet for these schools. Where there is no technological, like laptop, how to use Zooms, these educational things are now going on in our community. So this is like the positive aspect of it. We saw our gaps, and now we are trying to see how we can be able to fill those gaps.
May I ask a quick follow-up question about mobile technology? Have you found that it is helpful or particularly helpful for folks to be using mobile to access Zoom and education and to fill in some of the internet gaps? Or is that also a gap that needs to be addressed, having the mobile technology?
For us here in Sierra Leone, mobile technology is like very, very common. Most of the people here have access to mobile phones. So for me, I think we can be able to utilize that to be able to get access to Zooms, because since people here don't have access to computers, I think we can use the mobile phones for them to be able to access Zooms and other learning platforms.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Your intervention is very hopeful, and I'm looking forward to hearing more about this as we move forward. Linda, may I ask, what is your response to this same question? How has COVID-19 changed your landscape? What do you see? You're working in a very vibrant sector. FinTech is just really coming into its own, but that is primarily where there is internet access and where there's the skills to use this. What are you seeing from your perspective in this world, and what opportunities does the pandemic present to you?
Thank you, Pam, for the question. Yes, so we had, as all the other entrepreneurs in the world, we had many challenges during the pandemic time, and we are still facing them. In Albania, we were hit not only from the pandemic, but I need to mention that in 2019, we were hit by a big earthquake as well, which brought the economic crisis in deeper level, because we were hit twice. And you know that these fragile economies are very sensitive. Coming back to pandemic and COVID-19, I would like to share the perspective from the private sector in Albania, as well as from fintech sector, which I represent via EasyPay. Let me share with you how I started the day today in order to bring some optimism. I started the day with a regional network of STEM women. So it was a meeting between all STEM women, more than 60 women, talking about technology, innovation in Balkan, mathematics, and everything. Every woman was sharing what is happening in their countries, like Macedonia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Serbia, etc. I was impressed by the activities happening in all Balkan, even though all the countries are facing deep crisis. So women were sharing initiatives about mentorship, about entrepreneurship, about research that has been done in the region. So I think digitalization is happening in Balkan, is on the right path, and women are doing a qualitative shifts towards their representation in this male domination sector, as it is ICT. We do have some data about ICT representations in Albania and Kosovo are more or less in job market are more or less 30%. So we are still, it's good, but still in low level. What we were hit the most, or what was the biggest challenge from the business perspective for us, it was missing of resources due to the pandemic. Women are more hit with unpaid work and the health problems in their family. So we needed to keep the same rhythm of the business, having a lot of resources missing. From the client base, there were other challenges. So online payments were very increasing rapidly because everyone wanted to pay online. But the main challenge was that after the lockdown, so the shops and the economy came to normal, how to keep these customers stay online. This was the main challenge for us. Anyway, coming back to women and the access to innovation and technology, I would like to share the main barriers and how towards accessing technology and innovation. The first barrier is access to information and access to knowledge. I would like to share some statistics about my country. So the internet penetration in Albania is quite high. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, it's 72%. And the mobile penetration is pretty high, is 143%. So almost people, everyone has more than one mobile phone in their hand.
Yes.
And we should use this as an opportunity, a big opportunity for the Balkan region and Albania, for the women to access, to have access in information and to the knowledge. So not waiting to go in the school and to get information only from the schools or from university, but they have much, much bigger access, or even for starting a startup or to run a business. The second barrier that I would like to share is innovation. And I would like to emphasize this barrier. So technology is helping people towards having a higher education. And not only education, but I would like to emphasize the training and upskilling. We as EasyPay, we have done a lot in this field, especially in the financial inclusion and financial education. Albania, unfortunately, has still a high level of unbanked people. It's around 60% of the population is still unbanked. So financial literacy is still in low levels. And our focus with the technology and with the fintech revolution, which is happening here, it's to address these unbanked people. So how to make them access to finance and empower the women through this access to finance.
Thank you so much. I'd like to dip into those topics a bit more when we move into question and answer, but thank you. Very, very thought-provoking. I'm very happy to say that some of the panelists who were stuck in the waiting room have been able to make it in. So I'm going to go ahead and proceed. I would like to introduce Irlaki Nadarishvili. He is the Deputy Minister of Economy and Sustainable Development for the Government of Georgia. And Mr. Nadarishvili, we have been discussing how the pandemic, even though it has been absolutely profoundly problematic for the entire world and has brought so much suffering, in what ways might it be a possible, may it open some doors and opportunities for positive change in the area of gender equality? What is your view from the perspective of your work?
Hello, greetings everyone. I had some problems with entering the room, but I believe you can hear and
yes,
and see me now.
Perfect. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for this interesting question, but let me first tell you a little bit about Georgia's innovation ecosystem development in recent years. Keeping the momentum of Georgia's strong reform process, the government of Georgia clearly followed the path of sustainable development, where the adoption of innovations and technologies improves knowledge diffusion across sectors and supports startups internationalization, as well as equal human capital development. So altogether, this gives the country the advantage it needs to transform into a modern knowledge-based economy. And it was a strong milestone that Georgia started building the innovation ecosystem since 2014 and had the clear mandate towards sustainable industrial development, meaning the stimulation of innovation and modern technologies, facilitation of commercialization and usage of R&D, support of innovative startups and their competitive growth, and of course, facilitation of cooperation between representatives of science and businesses. One of the main challenges of this way, and particularly in the post-COVID recovery period, is to provide the workforce with the skills needed to meet the demands of a changing labor market, and more importantly, to ensure that women and girls are not left behind. Never has it been more vital to empower the role of women studying and working in digital technology. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, we all know and agree that around the world, women are underrepresented in the ICT employment sector, and without targeted interventions, women's limited participation in STEM will disadvantage them in the growing number of technical fields.
Yes.
But getting back to your question, let me tell you about our programs and the women's participation in them, if I may. We have the training programs for ICT and non-ICT specialists with particular attention on women participation in them. The courses culminate in exams to obtain internationally recognized certification, and another 3,000 individual trainees are to be trained through this program in the period of 2021-2022, the post-COVID recovery period. And the government of Georgia finances both trainings and certification exams for all 3,000 individuals. And here, women are specifically encouraged to participate. Another crucial part of our ecosystem is access to finance. So the Georgian government has mobilized the state funding for most risky stages of startups. And through small grants program, where startups are able to transform their ideas into prototypes, we have 96 women who gained grants out of the total 441 beneficiaries. It's not even a half of the total number, but we have the positive dynamic, which is most important for us. Another program which aims to stimulate entrepreneurial and innovative solutions is the matching grants program of 100,000 and 650,000 Georgian laris. This is about $30,000 and $200,000 grants program. They are running to promote startups and their global scalable innovative projects. So here during the period of the last 2 years from 2018 to 2020, among 95 winners, we have 33 female founder startups, which also is a good achievement for our ecosystem, for our new ecosystem. We have different programs, but let me tell you that, let me highlight that we believe that technology as a game changer for women and girls can make a reality where gender equality is well realized. And we are further planning to support STEM enrichment programs and encourage gender sensitive STEM learning environments to also to facilitate partnerships between startups, ICT companies and technology training programs to offer women and girls real world experiences. Equal representation of women in all spheres and at all levels of professional life will help counter discriminatory social norms and stereotypes that significantly hamper social development. We express readiness to deepen our resolve, increase our efforts towards women's involvement in technology, and define some new steps so to approach the sustainable development of our economy and innovation ecosystem. Thank you, and I'm ready for any questions.
Thank you so much. I really like your use of the term ecosystem. I think this is very important because in the end, we're trying to, all of us, make systemic change. And you can't do it just bit by bit. You've got to really look at the whole system from top to bottom and really approach it in a very, very organic way. Thank you so much. Very, very, very interesting. And then I'm going to turn now to Maria Jose Martinez. She is the advisor, International Affairs Department at the Ministry of Women and Gender Equality for the Government of Chile. And Maria, thank you for joining us today. I'm very, very interested to hear your response. You have had a lot of success and experience very specific to putting STEM programs and policies in place for women in Chile. Could you please expand a bit on some of the interventions specifically that you've put in place so we have some good exemplars to ground our discussion?
Muchas gracias, Pam, por la presentación y por la pregunta. Buenas tardes a todos y todas. Es un honor para mí estar acá representando a Chile, sobre todo nuestra calidad de líder de la Coalición de Acción de Tecnología e Innovación para la Equidad de Género del Foro Generación e Igualdad. Y también, al igual que el panelista que me antecedió, me gustaría poder contarles un poco en breve del contexto que estamos viviendo en nuestro país y luego más en específico de las distintas iniciativas que estamos tomando e impulsando para incentivar la participación de las niñas y mujeres en las áreas de STEM. Como ya mencionaron algunos otros panelistas, la pandemia en nuestro país no ha sido una excepción y ha dejado al descubierto múltiples desigualdades en el acceso, en las competencias, en el uso de herramientas tecnológicas y también la participación y liderazgo de las mujeres en las industrias de la ciencia y la innovación. En nuestro país, pese a que las mujeres estadísticamente acceden a más años de educación que los hombres, es mucho menos probable que las niñas y mujeres puedan acceder o optar por dedicarse a carreras en los campos de la ciencia, la tecnología, la ingeniería y las matemáticas, STEM. Sin embargo, y aquí me gustaría citar a una destacada joven programadora chilena, Valentina Muñoz, las niñas, y en nuestro país esto es una realidad, no nacen sintiéndose menos capaces en las áreas científicas o tecnológicas, sino que es el contexto social el que perpetúa esa idea. Sabemos que existen barreras multidimensionales que impiden a las mujeres y las niñas incorporarse y desarrollarse plenamente en los distintos ámbitos de la ciencia y la tecnología, como son los estereotipos, las normas sociales de cuidado, y también las expectativas de docentes, pares y familias. Los estudios han señalado que en Chile la brecha de género de las hombres y mujeres graduados en carreras STEM es 5 puntos mayor al promedio de la OCDE y es aún mucho mayor en comparación al promedio de otros países de Latinoamérica. Es en este contexto y teniendo en cuenta estos antecedentes que nuestro gobierno ha impulsado diversas iniciativas que se caracterizan por ser intersectoriales, es decir, involucrar a distintos ministerios, y también por incluir la perspectiva de género para incentivar e impulsar a que más niñas y mujeres ingresen y se puedan desarrollar en estas carreras. Primero, nuestro Ministerio de la Mujer y la Equidad y Género, junto con el Ministerio de Ciencia, Tecnología, Conocimiento e Innovación, han llevado a cabo la campaña Más Mujeres en Ciencia, que busca motivar a más niñas y jóvenes a que opten por estas carreras, especialmente para elevar la participación de las mujeres en carreras que han sido históricamente masculinizadas. Además, a comienzos de este año, presentamos una radiografía de género que revela las inequidades de nuestro sistema, y en la misma línea invitamos a la ciudadanía a participar de la primera consulta pública para elaborar una política de igualdad de género en las áreas de ciencia, tecnología, conocimiento e innovación, para incorporar las visiones del público general y también de la sociedad civil, e incorporar sus comentarios en un documento que tenga como eje garantizar el acceso de mujeres, integrar el enfoque de género en I+D, y también fortalecer la institucionalidad para mejorar las políticas públicas desde sistemas más diversos. Asimismo, nos sumamos a trabajar con UNESCO en el programa STEM and Gender Advancement, SAGA, cuyo fin es mejorar la situación de las mujeres en estas áreas y reducir la brecha de género en todos los niveles de educación e investigación, y específicamente recolectar datos desagregados por género, identificar brechas y mejorar el diseño de políticas públicas para aumentar la visibilidad y el reconocimiento del trabajo de las niñas y mujeres en estos campos de ciencia y tecnología. Además, con el Ministerio de Educación desarrollamos un plan de trabajo de educación con equidad de género para promover el acercamiento temprano de las niñas a estas áreas, derribar mitos y sesgos que las alejan de acceder a estos ámbitos, y también fortalecer modelos y ofrecerles role models para que ellas puedan generar nuevas perspectivas antes de iniciar sus carreras. Y por último, también estamos trabajando en materia de cooperación internacional, que les podría contar un poco más en la sección de preguntas y respuestas, pero estamos muy orgullosos y entusiasmados de ser líderes de la Coalición de Acción de Tecnología e Innovación, y desde allí estamos construyendo nuevas vías para lograr la plena participación y el liderazgo de mujeres en las sociedades digitales, y desde ya los dejo invitados a sumarse al trabajo de la coalición que se lanza mañana, y al cual esperamos que se sumen no solo con sus voces, sino que también con compromisos audaces y concretos para que entre todos podamos lograr una transformación digital equitativa.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that so much. And I would like to hear more about this as we move into question and answer this spectacular work. Thank you. Thank you so much. And now I would like to introduce to you Margarita Yepes. She is the co-founder of DataLat. Elle est la co-fondatrice de DataLat, emprendimiento ecuatoriano que promueve el uso efectivo de los datos abiertos y la tecnológica para promover soluciones innovadoras a problemas locales. Negocios Internacionales trabaja con proyectos de industria creativa y tecnológica cívica. Lidera proyectos de vinculación con la comunidad y el uso de datos abiertos para la toma de decisiones. Welcome, and thank you for being here. What is your response to how COVID-19 has changed equality for women and children?
Muchísimas gracias, Pam, y a todas las personas que nos acompañen. Bueno, en nuestro caso desde Ecuador, pues cómo podemos mejorar el acceso de mujeres a los datos en diferentes contextos. En Ecuador hemos hecho diversos esfuerzos para que más mujeres puedan acceder a datos de calidad. Durante la pandemia provocada por el COVID en 2019, pues sin duda nos permitió ver la dificultad que tenemos de acceder a datos de calidad, al menos en Ecuador. Para que estos datos nos sirvan para la toma de decisiones. Sin lugar a duda, en Ecuador hemos dado algunos pasos muy importantes en términos de datos abiertos, para que podamos analizar esa información y de esa manera trabajar en el desarrollo de políticas públicas que puedan apoyar a que mujeres y niñas no solo accedan a la tecnología, sino que empiecen a trabajar en otros temas que son de relevancia en asuntos de innovación, tecnología y demás. Sin embargo, en 2020, de abril a mayo, se dio a luz la política de datos abiertos en Ecuador, y nosotros desde DataLab, en conjunto con más organizaciones de la sociedad civil, como con academia, instituciones públicas, estuvimos trabajando para que esta guía de datos abiertos pueda ahora servir para la toma de decisiones. Es así que en Ecuador estamos trabajando con diversos colectivos, tanto de mujeres que necesitan acceder a estos datos para analizarlos, por ejemplo, en términos de violencia, de género, o de acceso a fuentes de información seguras para combatir contra la desinformación. Entonces, son como esos pequeños pasos que hemos dado a raíz de la pandemia, y que actualmente sabemos que necesitamos datos de calidad en formatos reutilizables para promover también una cultura de datos alrededor, en donde mujeres puedan acceder y crear políticas públicas en conjunto con diversas instituciones. Es así que también vemos muy de cerca, y estamos aprovechando muchísimo desde sociedad civil, que estemos ahora como parte de la Alianza de Gobierno Abierto, justamente para promover este acceso a datos. Varias de las panelistas mencionaron anteriormente lo importante que es que existan datos de calidad para la toma de decisiones e inclusive para trabajar en disminuir estas brechas digitales. Es lo mismo que estamos buscando desde Ecuador fervientemente para que podamos acceder a esta información, generando espacios de diálogo en donde hay diversos actores, desde la empresa privada, que en muchas ocasiones suele ser satanizada, pero en muchas otras ocasiones hemos logrado generar espacios de diálogo en donde trabajan sociedad civil, academia, instituciones públicas y las mujeres, sobre todo en espacios de tomas de decisiones de estas organizaciones, para que puedan trabajar en pro de acceder a datos de calidad, ¿no? También vemos muy de cerca lo importante que es desde la educación insertar una cultura de datos, o sea, que niños, niñas puedan acceder, inclusive analizar datos desde tempranas edades. ¿Y a qué me refiero con esto? Que en la educación hay muchas otras formas de insertar a niñas en tempranas edades para que, a través de juegos que tengan que ver con visualizaciones análogas, puedan jugar un poco más con información, y desde ahí empezamos ya a trabajar en una cultura de datos en tempranas edades. Es lo que hemos hecho desde DataLab en cuestiones. Tenemos actualmente una escuela de datos que se llama Datea, que lo que busca es justamente utilizar metodologías muy sencillas que lleguen a un público que no necesariamente tiene acceso a tecnología todo el tiempo. Y esa es la forma en la que sabemos que nosotros podemos apoyar a otras comunidades que no manejan tecnología, que no tienen una computadora, una laptop, pero sí tienen un dispositivo móvil y pueden trabajar con ello también como una herramienta para educar, que es algo que también mencionaron los panelistas. Y por eso creemos que la educación debe empezar con una cultura de datos en tempranas edades, e inclusive motivar a muchas niñas desde el análisis de datos análogo, para que ellas puedan ya trabajar con cifras muy pequeñas, solamente como para este ejercicio, como un poco como lo que se hace con, o sea, en este caso con tecnología cívica y con metodologías muy sencillas en donde se utilizan colores, imágenes, que son muy importantes para potencializar también la elección de una carrera que está más relacionada también a ciencias, tecnología, matemática, en donde las mujeres en Ecuador también ocupan espacios todavía entre un 40% aprox o un poco menos, que están todavía insertadas en estas carreras de tecnología que son tan importantes, y menos aún en temas de datos, ¿no? Entonces tenemos a movimientos de mujeres como Python Girls, Our Ladies y otras comunidades de mujeres que trabajan justamente con más mujeres para que se promueva este acceso y uso de datos de manera mucho más sencilla en diversos públicos, no solamente con tecnología, sino como les mencionaba, de manera análoga también. Eso es lo que les puedo decir.
Oh, thank you so much. I'd like to dig down into that a bit more in question and answer. I think that you are doing amazing work. Thank you so much. Thank you. And then Mr. Magnusson, I have not forgotten about you at all. And again, just to remind, Mr. Magnusson is Director for Partnerships and Outreach of the Social and Human Sciences Sector at UNESCO. So the question for you, this is work that UNESCO, this is a huge part of the core mission of UNESCO. In terms of what UNESCO is doing regarding the ethics of science and technology and promoting gender equality in the digital world, how can we foster gender transformative approaches through the development, for example, and deployment of artificial intelligence and machine learning, or AI and machine learning, and I would also include data, if you will, in that. And actually, I can speak about that as well, but just would very much like your take on that.
Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be part of the panel. First of all, of course, we're facing a unprecedented, I would say, crisis, health crisis. We're also facing a social and economic crisis, obviously, with now the UN is estimating up to 200 million people going back into extreme poverty. So we're really talking about a very severe backlash from this situation. At the same time, of course, we should also recognize that the pandemic has been a game changer in terms of the recourse to technologies. In record time, we've changed our existing kind of existence in a way, you know, we've moved a lot of it online, and we've changed our behavior in terms of where we work from, how we get our information, how we interact, even groceries, visits to the doctor, even that is online in some cases. So it's opened up a lot of paths. And some of these paths have included artificial intelligence all the time without us knowing it, and more and more so, right?
Yes.
So in fact, with us just changing our behaviors, we've also already taken on board artificial intelligence applications without really realizing in many cases, I would say. So this brings kind of the question that you posed, and the ethical dimensions of AI, and relational ethics is adaptive, and ethics is one area of UNESCO's work. It allows for adjustments that respond to how people and technologies interact with each other and change each other. So the result is a method for practicing ethics that critically assesses the situation, imagines different ways of living, and builds the structures that make those lives possible. So ethics, in a way, is a third path. You have kind of a scientific path to finding solutions. You have a political path, and you have an ethical path, which asks some different questions, right? And these questions regarding the pandemic were quite specific. And also the UNESCO experts did have two statements that were issued on the pandemic. But we know that the artificial intelligence world is a male-dominated one. The World Economic Forum estimates that 3 years ago, that only 22% of AI professionals globally were women. And recent statistics suggest that now this percentage has decreased to 12%.
Oh.
So only 6% of software developers worldwide are women. And one of the many consequences of this relative absence of diversity and gender parity in this sector is development of biases in programs, in algorithms that further gender stereotypes and marginalize women and girls. This is a fact. And examples are many. This goes from voice and face recognition performing much worse for women than for men.
Yes.
Meaning that AI systems are not developed with women as consumers in mind, to search engines, or personal assistants replicating harmful gender stereotypes.
Mm-hmm.
UNESCO's a publication called I'd Blush If I Could, in addition to outlining the persistence and severity of the gender gap in digital skills and providing recommendations to address this problem, The publication also examines exactly how AI voice assistants perpetuate harmful gender stereotypes. The title actually of the publication is a response that Siri used to give, not anymore, when a user would tell her, hey Siri, you're a, and I won't say the word. And this reaction was changed in 2019, but it was still used for 8 full years since the technology's wide release in 2011. So this is why it is important to be mindful of all of these inequalities and biases and to proactively work at building an inclusive, transparent, and accountable artificial intelligence ecosystem which represents our diverse societies. And the full participation of women and girls as both consumers and producers of AI innovations is crucial to the development of an inclusive digital world. And because AI systems can inherit, reflect, perpetuate, and exacerbate existing gender stereotypes and other social biases, they can also overcome them and promote more inclusive mindsets, attitudes, and behaviors, particularly if we go very deeply into the data sets, and not generally, but specifically.
Yeah.
And this needs to be in each subsector. We can't talk about this generally. You have to go into each subsector and see how these databases are constructed. So for instance, AI can be used to surface biases in hiring and promoting. That is the case with automatic screeners highlighting adjectives, considering as masculine in job descriptions that discourage women from applying for leadership positions. So specific words can be picked up by AI that then discriminate against women. This is happening. We know that's happening. With that in mind, UNESCO is working to deliver the first global normative framework in the field of AI. And we recently held a global consultation with high-level experts from around the world who provided us with the detailed pictures of how AI impacts women negatively. And we drafted together with these experts a draft recommendation on the ethics of artificial intelligence that we hope will be used as a guiding template for regulating AI in the future after adoption by UNESCO member states, 193 member states, hopefully in November this year. And it's because the AI revolution needs a moral compass. That's why we do this. And profit cannot be the only incentive. So the foundation of this recommendation is respect, protection, and promotion of human dignity, human rights, and fundamental freedoms. And no human being should be harmed physically, economically, socially, politically, or mentally during any phase of the life cycle of AI systems. On the contrary, quality of life should be enhanced through AI systems. So in this regard, UNESCO's recommendation will help governments regulate the AI sector to do three things: to overcome the built-in gender biases found in AI devices, data sets, and algorithms by ensuring inclusive AI development teams, representative training data, and formal assessments of the impact of AI practices on gender. Improve the global representation of women in technical roles and in boardrooms in the technology sector by investing in digital literacy and ensuring incentives for gender parity in the public and private sector. And finally, to create robust gender inclusive AI principles, guidelines, and codes of ethics within the industry. And just final comment, for a gender transformative approach to AI to be effective, it has to be a standalone principle and not addressed merely by attaching some stock phrase like with a particular focus on gender aspects, end quote, to a mass of other concerns. Concern for gender equality is not a subset of a general concern for bias in the development and use of algorithms. And this implies to governments, private sector, civil society, international organizations, technical communities, academia, they must respect human rights instruments and frameworks in their interventions and the process surrounding the life cycle of AI systems. So new technologies need to provide new means to advocate, defend, and exercise human rights and not to infringe them. And of course, particularly, this needs to also reflect the work ethics in the private sector. So regulation is important by government, but also self-regulatory dimensions. And those are also part of UNESCO's networks. But this will be a recommendation adopted by governments and the first global normative instrument on AI. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. They're very intriguing. I agree with you. Gender is not just simply a subset of bias. It is its own discipline and it has its own issues. I remember well looking at there was a large report put out by NIST, a standards organization in the US in regards to a 2-year study in regards to face recognition in particular. And face recognition, of course, is a today's face recognition is all machine learning and AI. And their findings were shocking. The fact that, for example, a system that is so important for identity and authentication and whatnot, for it to have that pronounced of a gender bias was really, was quite shocking when I first read that report. Thank you. And I look forward, all of us look forward to reading that. I'm just going to wrap up all of these really, really wonderful interventions with just a quick summary from my own perspective, if I may. I want to focus a little bit on how COVID-19 accelerated what I call a digital first society and what that means. Last year, actually it started in October of 2019, the Center for Global Development and the World Privacy Forum, where I'm the executive director, we started a joint study on data in the context of development. And this was inclusive of AI. And of course, after our work began, we hit the pandemic. And so we redid our methodology after much consternation and thinking. And we started to focus on, okay, what changes with the pandemic? Our focus was on the LMICs or, you know, the non-wealthy nations. And I think the thing that really, really surprised me the most is that there were the problems cut very deep and they were quite systemic. And if you add then, you know, questions about gender, then you would see even additional issues there. So the things, there are just 5 quick things I would say about how things have changed and what the opportunity might be and what it's shown us. One is that I do believe that across all jurisdictions, we need much greater numeracy and much better data and more comprehensive and accurate data about women and girls. We don't yet have that. And if even just one jurisdiction does not have comprehensive statistical data about girls and women, then all of us suffer, because we really need to understand what's happening out there on the ground. We need a real understanding. And I think having very, very good data collection that's disaggregated for women and girls safely, with a lot of, you know, protections around how that data is used, then I think we would all be better off. And then several of you mentioned something I think I think is very important, which is that we need to involve women and girls in design. And I heard you all say things that I would have said. So several of you talked about institutional design. Some of you talked about, you know, data systems and learning systems and access to the internet. I would add that it's very important that we include women and girls in the design and function of identity systems. If you look throughout the world, one of the linchpins for data really is how we are identified, and do we have access to government issued identification? This is a very deep topic, but it's also quite central to the question of gender, because sometimes in jurisdictions, what you'll find is that most men have an ID and most women don't. And when you get on the ground and start asking women and girls why they don't have ID, it's usually very simple. It's because they didn't have a mobile phone, or sometimes it's because the place where you had to go sign up for ID was was frightening or not too far away, or, you know, other barriers that would be very simple to solve. And where, you know, certain companies, there are a variety of mobile operators, for example, who took this on and decided to move, for example, identity stations in the market, so that when women went shopping, they could just sign up without having to go to any extra errand or place. So simple design thinking like this, I think, is very important. And then just to finish up, several of you also mentioned leadership. I really believe in leadership training for all girls and women, and to allow people to have the skills of leadership. And it is a skill. It's not some, you know, hazy gift that comes to us. It's a learned thing, and women and girls in all countries, in all jurisdictions, can learn these skills. And I think a real effort to focus on these would be very, very important. So we have arrived at the time for us to interact with questions from the audience. So I'm going to go ahead and select some of these. So let's take a look. All right, I see a lot of great questions. So this is a great audience. We're very, very lucky. Okay. So Magnus, I think this may go to you, but please, if there are any other panelists who would like to jump in on this, please just raise your hand and let me know, and I'll come to you after. But Magnus, how would you do these two things? How would you incorporate specifically the gender perspective into algorithms? That's part A. And then part B would be, how could we move on to a serious approach regarding smart cities with a gender perspective? That is a phenomenal question, both of them. But Magnussen, what are your responses to that?
Well, thank you very much for that question. Indeed, two very good questions. Let me start with the cities aspect. I mean, inclusive cities is an area where UNESCO actually is working. We have a network of inclusive cities called ICAR globally and ECAR for the European one that looks particularly at inclusivity and anti-discrimination of all forms, and mayors come together and exchange lessons learned and approaches. And what we hear from these hands-on experiences very much is what you already said, Pam. You know, it really comes down to working with young people, men and women, to change stereotypes in families, in school. And, you know, be mindful also of stereotypes that circulate on the internet. I think it's very important to be, you know, at least to try to be on top of it for particularly younger, for youth and children that are starting to use the internet. But also to ensure, and these are all the stereotypes in terms of, you know, math, you know, engineering. There was a study done by the OECD with the number of girls who say they want a career in engineering or computer science is as low as 2%. Mm. Where does that come from, right? That's, you're not born with that, right? That you don't want to work on computer science. This is something that the girls are socialized into, right? And with that, teachers potentially as well. So it is at that level. I think also when it then comes to the planning of cities, you have to include women, obviously, and also young girls, young women, so youth women, in the planning of city-related policies and decisions. And in several cities around the world now, you can see the emergence of youth councils, where women and young men are sitting together, in some cases even have a voice, a decision, a deciding voice, like in some cities in Finland. In other cities, at least, have an advisory role for decisions, right? So co-creation, different generations, but particularly have women involved in the decision processes. So that's one aspect, and many others, I would say, on the city level. On the first question, I'm not an expert on algorithms, but I think, you know, algorithms are based on data. So it comes back to the data dimension. Of course, an algorithm is designed by a computer specialist to do certain things and pick certain things up and leave other things out, provide, you know, maybe also within big data, provide solutions. What's great about AI is, we should never forget all the positive things about AI that can really, you know, promote the achievement of the SDGs if used correctly. AI is great in analyzing big data, for example, without biases, right? In fact, if you count all the human biases that we use without knowing, and an AI application can actually be much more unbiased. But when the data, in fact, includes biases from the start, it is very difficult to control it, right? So I think it really, the answer to that, I think, should be that, as I said earlier, you have to go into very specific data sets. You have to understand what data sets are being used for what algorithms and AI applications. And this goes generally for AI, particularly in these days when we've talked about the risks and benefits of AI for years now. It doesn't really make sense to talk about it so generally. You know, you really need to go into the granularity of it. The devil is in the detail, as they say. And that's really true for AI and algorithms and the data they're based on. Thanks.
Yes, I definitely find myself agreeing with you. There was a moment, I'd say 5, 6 or so years ago, maybe 7 years ago at the most, when everyone was scrambling to make principles. I think we all remember them. But now, for example, we have the OECD principles and we have other principles. We have lots of principles, and there is now a real pattern to the principles. We know that we're looking at fairness, accuracy, transparency, explainability, some of these other issues in AI. And I agree, it is time now to take the next step, a really big step, and get more granular and understand that we're going to have some specialization in AI going forward. And I agree with that. I think that is definitely a very good idea for becoming part of the solution. It's not actually something I thought of. So thank you. That's, I think, a very important idea. Okay. Hawa, thank you. You've been so patient. I have a question for you from the audience. We have a gap between generations, and you are working with youth. And so I'm particularly interested in your response. So the question is that because the millennial generation just simply grew up with the technology, but didn't necessarily have to go out and gain a lot of skills. They just learned how to adapt the technology to their lives. What happens for women and girls when this has happened? What happens if they don't have the same kinds of opportunities within the current labor market, especially with technologies from Industry 4.0 or the very latest technologies? Is this something that you see? Do you see that there is, you know, the millennials just simply kind of like, you know, driving a car, they know the technology, but they can't, you know, look inside the machine and correct it, so to speak, or to fix it? Or what is your perception of this? And if this problem exists, what would you propose to do to close this gap?
Thank you so much. That is a very great question. So yeah, looking at young people, especially for here in Sri Lanka, I can definitely tell you that they have knowledge about technology. They know how to operate a cell phone even without teaching them. They know how computer works. But then coming back to their, you know, learning this as a skill, learning this as something that they can earn from, that is something that is missing. So what we normally do, so working at the lab, you find out that there are kids that comes in and they know everything that is happening there. They know how the machines works, but then in terms of the component, they don't know. So basically what we do is we teach them the component, which is very, very much important. So we notice that the idea is there, the knowledge is there, but then how can we improve in this knowledge? How can we be able to use that knowledge to create something that is meaningful in their, meaningful in the community? So basically we teach these kids, we teach them about how this component works, what we can do. Let's say, for example, there is so my work mostly is solar energy. They can come in and they know how these things work. But then in terms of measurement, like how many watts of energy is needed to power certain appliances. So we have to teach these kids, and then they can be able to apply these things with their knowledge. So it's basically like very, so you notice that they're fast learners in terms of, you know, technological appliances. So it makes our work very, very easy. But then definitely I can tell you that the idea is there, the knowledge is there, but then they need to go more in depth of that knowledge. So that is where we comes in. So we teach them more about what the in depth of that knowledge that they have.
That's incredible. Thank you so much. That is a great answer. And I am absolutely grateful that you were here to provide that perspective. Thank you so much. I have now a question in Spanish for Maria Joseph Martinez and Margarita Yepes. Is there someone who can read this in Spanish so that I do not mess that question up like I did the last time I tried to read Spanish? Is there someone who can do that?
Hola, buenas tardes, María José y Margarita. Mi nombre es José. Yo le voy a leer la pregunta en español. ¿Cómo pueden las empresas tecnológicas privadas contribuir a reducir la brecha digital que afecta a las mujeres de base y a las actividades económicas que desarrollan mayoritariamente en la informalidad? Y la segunda parte de la pregunta es, ¿cómo extender alguna de las medidas e iniciativas digitales que han sido efectivas durante la pandemia para ser más inclusivos con aquellas mujeres que tienen menos acceso? Gracias.
Disculpen, una pregunta. ¿Esto es solo para mí o también para María José?
Both. Para las dos.
Ah, para las dos. Perfecto.
Yes. Gracias.
Entonces, disculpa, ¿puedes repetir nuevamente, porfa, la primera pregunta? Porque se cortó muchísimo.
Ok, la primera parte es, ¿cómo pueden las empresas tecnológicas privadas contribuir a reducir la brecha digital que afecta a las mujeres de base y a las actividades económicas que desarrollan mayoritariamente en la informalidad?
Perfecto. Muchas gracias.
Ok. Y la segunda parte de la pregunta es, ¿cómo extender algunas de las medidas e iniciativas digitales que han sido efectivas durante la pandemia para ser más inclusivos con aquellas mujeres que tienen menos acceso?
Ya, perfecto.
Gracias.
Perfecto, muchas gracias. María José, si te parece, como tengo el micrófono abierto, la respondo muy rápido yo y ya. Perfecto. Bueno, en la primera pregunta, ¿cómo podrían las empresas privadas? Bueno, nosotros desde el Data Lab somos una fundación, pero nos hemos llevado gratas sorpresas con cámaras de comercio y empresas que trabajan en temas de tecnología, con las cuales hemos podido realizar diferentes tipos de capacitaciones abiertas al público. Bueno, actualmente son digitales, pero antes de la pandemia, entrelazamos como muchas redes de contactos con diversos actores que nos permitan justamente desde el lado privado y con el conocimiento que saben, que tienen en sus empresas, extenderlo hacia un público mucho más general y que está como súper curioso de aprender más cosas en términos de análisis de datos. Por eso les mencionaba anteriormente que es muy importante el lenguaje simple que se utiliza para trasladar esta información hacia públicos que no están totalmente digitalizados, que no tienen acceso siempre a dispositivos tecnológicos. Y esa es una forma en la que podemos entrelazar justamente aquello que no tiene sociedad civil, que en muchas ocasiones es tal vez infraestructura tecnológica o espacios de capacitación, pues las empresas pueden suplir estos espacios para llegar a más gente. Entonces nosotros creemos mucho en lo importante que es generar ecosistemas en donde no solamente sea un actor que dirige este tipo de procesos, más bien que se entrelazan con academia, que también es un actor muy importante para trabajar en términos de disminuir brechas digitales y también brechas de conocimiento y generar pues todas estas capas de conocimiento para gente que está muy curiosa pero que no puede acceder a una educación formal, y esa es una forma. Por otra parte, iniciativas que nos han funcionado muy bien desde Ecuador es aquellas en donde se hace como pequeños espacios de capacitación con herramientas muy puntuales que sabemos que a la gente le puede servir muchísimo para aplicarlos en el día a día. O sea, no todas las personas pueden pagar una licencia de una plataforma para analizar datos, pero tenemos un Google Spreadsheets que nos permite trabajar en eso. Entonces son como estas formas también en donde vamos dirigiendo herramientas que a la gente le permite trabajar de manera mucho más accesible y que no necesitan pagar una licencia. Es por eso también que nos hemos unido con comunidades de desarrollo de software libre para que con ellos podamos encontrar diferentes herramientas que puedan llegar a más personas. Lamentablemente ahorita muy digitales, sí, pero en el momento en el que ya podamos dar pasos más seguros de modo que se empiece el proceso de vacunación y demás, en muchos países de América Latina yo creo que vamos a abrir espacios nuevamente en donde abrimos a estas personas que pueden aprender a través del uso de herramientas que no son solo digitales, ¿no? Sino nuevas formas de hacerlo también sin acceder a tecnología, sino de manera análoga. Listo, creo que me extendí. Disculpa, María José. Gracias.
Thank you.
Gracias, Margarita. Gracias, Pam. Bueno, para responder, primero que todo, muy buena pregunta y me gustaría responder un poco en distintos niveles. Primero hablar de acceso a las mujeres que o no tienen acceso o tienen un acceso muy limitado. Por otra parte, el desarrollo de competencia y capacitación hacia mujeres en términos de herramientas digitales. Y por último, un poco las alianzas que estamos realizando con el sector privado para que ellos contribuyan. Coincido con lo que señalaba Margarita en que muchas iniciativas que hemos implementado a propósito de la pandemia que de todas formas llegaron para quedarse. Por ejemplo, en términos de capacitación y de entrega de herramientas básicas para mujeres de competencias digitales para poder, tanto a nivel de usuario, intermedio o incluso más avanzado, poder ocupar y hacer uso de la tecnología. El año pasado creamos un programa que se llamaba Mujer Digital, que contó con actividades de capacitación para más de 12.000 mujeres en el país, y que dado el éxito que tuvo específicamente por la contingencia, es que un programa que decidimos repetir este año, volver a ampliar, este año estamos ofreciendo más de 59 cursos abiertos para mujeres que cuentan con acceso a internet, y esperamos poder replicarlo hacia adelante. Pero un paso anterior a eso, en términos de acceso, sabemos que en Chile hay hogares que o no están conectados por temas técnicos de localización, lugares donde no llega conexión, o bien también tenemos muchos hogares en que, especialmente los hogares más vulnerables, que sabemos que en Chile mayoritariamente son liderados por mujeres, que no cuentan con los medios para poder contar con internet y dispositivos móviles en su casa, y para ello estamos junto con CEPAL trabajando en un programa propuesto por ellos de crear una canasta digital básica. Estamos trabajando junto a otros ministerios como el de Desarrollo Social y la Subsecretaría de Telecomunicaciones para ver cómo podemos dar acceso a los hogares no conectados más vulnerables del país, liderados por mujeres, a través al menos de algún subsidio en forma de datos que les permita poder conectarse, y una vez conectados luego ya acceder a nuestros programas de capacitación en habilidades digitales que estamos expandiendo. Y en cuanto al sector privado, sobre todo en temas de participación de las mujeres en la industria tecnológica, nosotros creemos que son un actor y socios clave, y hemos estado trabajando con ellos. Por una parte, tenemos una alianza con el BID y con Laboratoria, que creamos un programa Emprender Conectadas, que permita a emprendedoras que no tenían conocimiento, o bien muy poco conocimiento y un nivel de usuario bastante bajo en herramientas tecnológicas, poder capacitarse en estas herramientas, no solo emprendimiento, sino que de habilidades digitales, para poder escalar y potenciar sus negocios a través de las nuevas vías de comercializar que sabemos que son a través del mundo digital. Y también estamos trabajando de forma bien importante, sobre todo por aquellas mujeres que no están integradas en la industria, que en nuestro país son esencialmente masculinizadas y que son claves también estas industrias para el proceso de recuperación, como son la minería, la construcción, las telecomunicaciones, etc. Hemos instalado distintas mesas, como la mesa de mujer y minería y construcción, energía y telecomunicaciones, para avanzar directamente con los gremios y con las empresas de estas industrias en programas de acción afirmativa y también de concientización de la perspectiva de género para que estas mujeres no solamente puedan ingresar a estos distintos ámbitos laborales, sino que también puedan escalar y no contar con obstáculos horizontales que no les permitan llegar a puestos de decisión y liderazgo.
Okay. Thank you so, so much. Muchas gracias. Okay. So this conversation feels like it has only been 3 minutes long. You have all been fantastic. So I want to thank all our panelists. I have taken from all of the wealth that you have said, I am taking away 3 highlights, and this does not do justice to the richness of the conversation, but I think we can fit everything in under these 3 highlights. So first, there is such a big difference between legislation on the books and the reality on the ground. We can have all the laws in the world that say women and girls are equal, but if in our reality of day to day, there is not equality, well, we have to make it real. And I really liked the idea of a path of ethics, something beyond just, you know, national legislatures, something that really puts the meat on the bones of all of the principles that we have worked on, all of us, but to move forward, to really take the ideas and to put them into practice in a very granular way, which brings me to the second point, which is the work of each of you who have spoken today is highly granular, highly specific, and enormously diverse. And even just this in and of itself teaches us something very important. The field of, and the idea, and the issue of gender equality is not at its beginning anymore. And it is time to specialize and to find and ensure that we have subspecialties within the idea of gender equality and find out where all of our talents allow us to best fit within that and work in very specific ways. Even though it might not feel like we're achieving anything, all of you are proof that if we do our utmost as individuals, we will achieve something as long as we keep hope and keep moving forward. And something else that has really been very striking to me in this conversation is that we must remember always the building blocks. Even when things are high tech, even during a pandemic, we always have to be building skills, building leadership skills, building STEM and math skills, building workplaces that allow girls to want to go into AI, into engineering, or to become a doctor, or whatever it is that they wish. So we have a lot of work ahead of us, but all of you have already done exceptionally important work. And I thank all of you for sharing your knowledge and your expertise and your passion and work with us. And thank you to the Generation Equality Forum. And the forum will continue through this week. I will be attending the sessions and I'm looking forward to them. And I hope to see all of you again. And thank you again so, so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to participate.
Muchas gracias.
Real pleasure.
Qué gusto.
Muchas gracias a todos.
You guys are fabulous.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.